I'm Wesley Sanders. I'm Chief Lighting Engineer for the Dryden High School Auditorium.
And I'm Greg Austin. I'm the Photon Generation Relocation Engineer, also known as the Gaffer.
And we're going to teach you today a little bit about lights. Now, there are a lot of different jobs in the theater with lighting, and the one that ultimately controls the creative nature of the entire show of the lighting is the lighting designer. There's also the master electrician who's in charge of implementing this vision. There are the electricians, there are the gaffers, there are the spotlight operators. There are many different people that have to come together to bring a lighting design in lights.
However, in a high school performance, you normally have two people and they share all those responsibilities together.
Yeah, but the ultimate... you can fix that in post, right?
Yes, we can fix that.
Okay,
in post.
Okay. So we're gonna cut that part out.
Okay.
Anyway, the ultimate goal of the lighting designer is to take the director's vision and put it into lights, and to make it come alive, to bring a simple idea, a sunrise, you know, maybe love, maybe joy, maybe anger, maybe fury.
Come!
Passion. Whatever, put it into lights and to ultimately make the audience more able to understand the action, more able to understand what a character is going through, more understand what the ultimate underpinnings of a drama is.
Lights can do also many, many things besides set moods. They can also set time of day. If a lot of times shows only have one set and you can only use lights to capture the time of day, and it's a great way to do many, many things.
Now, modern lighting design has really only been around for the past 50 years, but there have been, even thousands of years ago, the Greek theater were set up in ways so that the actors' faces were illuminated by the light of the sun. And this also began the first cries of, it's too bright, by actors.
Which, by the way, you will be hearing a lot if you choose to take on this job, especially if you do the elementary shows or middle school shows.
So, but ultimately, in the 1700s and 1800s, there were actually lighting designs that came together by candle lighting, gas, and mostly a lot of burning theaters. But with the advent of electrical incandescent lights,
it became a lot cheaper to do this.
And a lot less dangerous. Although there were still many fires until the advent of servo-controlled dimmers, which came around in the 1950s, and ultimately the dawn of computer-controlled lighting design, which had revolutionized the way things were. Just 4 years ago, this high school had an analog lighting system where every scene had to be reset every night. And now, with the new modern electronic theater controls technology, we're now able to design an entire show, program it into our lighting board, and now make it to where it's a simple process to run, it's almost seamless, and there are a lot fewer things that can go on.
Kids today are so lucky. I mean, come on. You press a button.
See, back in my day, in order to get to the lighting booth, you had to walk up a hill 15 miles both ways. It didn't matter. It was terrible. And it was snowing.
Snowing
in the light booth. It was awful. But things have really changed, and lighting design has been revolutionized.
Nice. Yes, it is very
so
nice.
So in today's video, we're going to discuss general ideas of lighting design, the practical applications of it, and how to use the equipment here in the Dryden High School Auditorium. So, let's come take a look inside. To the light booth.
Turn it on. This is the ETC Express 4896 lighting console. The lighting switch, if you just put your hand right back here and reach down, you're going to find the power switch. It's the only switch back there. You just flip it.
It's a PG5 though, so don't worry.
You'll see the boot screen coming up, this light turning on, and things are just going to come to life pretty soon. As we wait, you can talk about the weather. So, how are you doing?
That's fine.
Yeah. All right, so it's on, so I don't really care anymore. So, and now we're here at the boot screen of the ETC Express 4896. It shows all channels 1 through 96 and what level they're on. Right now they're all at 0, We'll give this a shot, and you'll notice. And you'll notice that various, that the different channels that have come on are now showing what percentage they're at. So the basic operation of this lighting board is each dimmer, each fader is connected to a channel, which is connected to a dimmer, which is connected to a circuit. And in the professional theaters, those will often have lots of different numbers. They're all the same here. So fader one is connected to dimmer one, which is connected to circuit one, which
fader's connected to the channel.
So,
the channel.
So when you're
to the circuit,
you can shut up. So when we hook up a light, if we wanted to hook it up to channel one, we hook it up to the similarly labeled circuit in wherever we're hooking up. That channel one happens to be in the cove, and so when I hook up channel one of the lights in the cove comes up. And it's the same thing with all of these. These faders just rise proportionally to however high you are. And then there are also these buttons down here. They're the bump buttons. For as long as you're holding this button down, the light that it's under will be up at 100%. And you can do that if you ever get bored.
But not during a show.
Usually. And then there's also, this is a very important fader, the master fader.
Ooh.
And this name probably implies it. Controls the master level of all the switches. So right now I've got all these random channels up. It's going to pull them out all down by 50% of whatever their level is. And now, you'll notice all the lights are on, but there's this handy button called the blackout button, which I disabled because you don't want to hit that usually unless there's a good reason to. And
basically, it turns off the lights. It would go like this, and then you would turn it on, and it would go like this. If the little light's on, it looks like this. If the light's off, it looks like this.
So one of the important things to do when you start a show is a few things you want to check. One, make sure that this thing is off. We learned that the hard way on the opening night of Romeo and Juliet, the first show that students ran this lighting board for. We had pulled this lighting together design in just days. Everything was perfect. It was all coming together amazingly. And then the call was blackout. Because we were ready to start the show. And I turn it down. Blackout! I'm working on it. Why isn't it coming down? And then the actors start coming on stage, but all the lights aren't on in the right place. So, luckily, Nathan Plumeau, one of the former...
I will demonstrate this.
All right, please. No, okay, you be Nathan, and I'll be me. Blackout!
Why isn't it working, Wes?
Blackout!
Oh no, the devil's gone! No!
And once again, the day was saved. But that's one of the important things to always make sure, is that everything is configured to where you have complete control over it. And sometimes it's not a bad idea to just, before you start the show, hit this button. Because someone could have turned on the panel backstage and you didn't know. People sometimes do that. Because
another good idea is the night of a show, put a nice big piece of gaff tape right over the panel so that people don't use it.
So that's kind of the basic operation of the board. A little later, we'll get into programming cues, programming submasters, parking faders, programming effects cues.
And lines and...
Yeah, doing lots of things that really, that's your lighting design is where you just program the cues that you have come before, that you have decided are going to make up your show, you program it, and then it's simple enough to run it. You just hit go every time your cue comes up.
If we pull this down to zero, there are still lights on. There is an easy way to fix this. Right in the corner back here, there's actually a panel. This panel right here
is the ETC Unison Architectural Controls, developed by ETC in 1997.
You can shut up now. It basically is a separate way to turn on the lights. There's one back in the stage right corner of the auditorium. That way, teachers can actually turn on the lights in the auditorium without having to come back to the light booth to actually do that. It's a very great system, except for if you have a light on there and you turn it off here, that thing overrides this, so make sure that it's always turned off.
Which can be done by pressing the conveniently labeled off switch button. And now watch.
Yeah, and now the lights slowly go down.
And now, we control the lights that are...
The master.
By turning the master back up, we can turn all the lights, yay, we have full control now.
We're going to hang a source 4.
Now, one thing to keep in mind when you're hanging these is different degrees in a source 4. This one is a 26 degree. We have 35 degree and 19 degree ones as well. So, and that talks about how wide that's going to spread out.
Literally, the lights are actually angled on the inside, and the wider the angle, the more area they're going to cover. So if you have a 19 degree, it's not going to cover that much space. But if you have a 36 degree, then it's going to cover a lot more. So you may.
But it's also going to be
consideration.
So, but if it's a wider angle, it's also going to be less bright along the whole area. So if you need a focus bright something, you want a 19. But if you want a nice wide area that's not going to be too bright, you want a 36. So,
what do we have?
Source 4.
Right now, we're going to hang on here. In reality, you never hang a source 4 on this bar. Don't mind the scratches on there from past hangings of it. But for purposes of today, we think it'll be a lot easier to show you how to work this thing if it's at a reasonable height. So we're going to show you how to install it.
So here are the tools you need. First, you need your source 4. You also need a safety cable and a wrench. And if you've been working, if you're changing the way this light has been, if you've moved it around, it may be hot and you may need gloves.
Yes, right now this is not hot, so I'm not going to wear gloves. But other than that, you would normally wear gloves if this is hot.
Okay, so the first thing, before we tighten it down, we better get a safety cable off here. So,
the most important rule of lights while hanging them is always have a safety cable. No matter what, you want a safety cable.
Yeah, if this light falls, the light may break, but it can only go as far as the safety cable will let. The light may be damaged, but there's no one's going to be hurt by it.
Yes, if this is on stage and it falls, and it hits someone, that's generally frowned upon.
Yeah,
if it's on the safety cable, it'll only fall until this thing catches it.
Yeah, because having a hot, really heavy object falling from a high distance on you, I wouldn't recommend it.
Yes. Now, the way this hooks through is obviously you can see it's a loop. It just goes around this bar and it goes through the inside of this light right here. So that way you can actually hook it up. Now, the next part of it is simply wrenching it in. You can do the first part with your hand because that would save a lot of time.
Yep, so you just tighten it down till it's, I need that higher. So, and you also want it to be flush with your surface.
And then you just simply tighten it.
Yep, and you don't want to get it too tight, but you want to get it tight enough to where the person who's holding it can feel that it's stable and that they don't need to hold it anymore. So you don't need to tighten it that much. Is it feel stable?
It needs to be tightened quite a bit more.
All right, how does it feel now?
It feels pretty good. It's not moving at all. See,
okay.
If you move, you can shake it a little bit and it won't move. That's a good sign.
So, and then the next part is going to be adjusting the light to where however you need it. And of course, you're also gonna have to plug it in. There will be a circuit. And we have a demonstration box set up right here. Now, so, you're gonna plug it in, and it's not on, so there it is. So, and then you're gonna have these shutters, which it adjusts the opposite side from which it is. So, if you'll take a look at this light up here, you can see right now it's just a bright circle, so let's see what it looks like when we put a gel in here. I'm gonna put a red gel inside the light. And that's gonna hopefully make the light red.
Again, to do this, we are going to simply unhook this, slide the gel right in there, and lock it. And now we have a nice orange gel, because it's not actually red. Once again, that's why you want to look at the gel before you actually put it in. Okay, now that we have the light gel, there are many things we can do with it. We can either aim it where we want, position it, or we can put a gobo in it. And right now, we're going to show you how to use those gobos.
Now, a gobo is actually short for go-between. And I'm not really sure why, because there's no O in between. But they didn't ask me. So, a gobo is just a pattern that goes between the light, and it changes how the light looks. We've got our sun here. Sun, sun, Mr. Golden Sun. All of our gels are filed under lobster in the file cabinet.
Actually, all of our gels are put in those pizza boxes up there.
All right, right.
And all of our gobos are actually in the lobster folder.
So in the lobster folder, you'll find your gels and your gel frame.
Or your gobo and your gobo frame.
All right, so this is a gobo. So you just get your gobo and you slide it in the frame. It's simple enough. Yeah, there's an opening, and you slide it in. Slide it in. Sometimes they don't quite make sense, so it's one of those times. Now that your gobo is in your frame well enough, there's a slot above one of the shutters.
We'll actually move this around so you can see it.
Above this shutter right here, you can see there's an extra slot. Okay? Now what you do is you simply take the gobo and you insert it into that slot. As you can see, we have our sun, but it looks crappy. So, there's a way to fix that. The best way to fix that is by focusing it. You can adjust this little knob right here by turning it.
And now at this point, that lens may be very hot.
No, it is very hot.
So you'll want to wear our trusty lighting gloves.
It works better if one person has both of them, though.
Fine.
So, you're going to help me, though, Wes, because this takes two people to adjust this. Because what's going to happen is I am going to move this up and down, and when we find the right height, he's going to adjust it. So if you look up at the sun right now, you can actually see as I pull it and push it, etc., it changes how focused it is. So we're going to find it where it looks pretty good, which is right up there, and we're going to tighten it.
I'm going to hold it right in place while he tightens it.
All right. And you'll notice that I'm tightening this screw to where now this lens is going to stay in place.
So we have our light now focused.
Okay, so now we're going to look at programming submasters. A submaster is just a fader that has several different lights programmed onto it. If you look at this, I'm going to push up submaster number 7, and if you look on stage, it turned on quite a few lights. That's actually our cove submaster. So that's most of the lights in our cove area. So, and then I'm going to bring this down, and now if you look back at the board, I'm going to show you how to program that. So what you do with that is you just find the light that you want to set your scene, that you want on this submaster. You know what? I think I need light 19, 37, 68, 91, and 75. Isn't that beautiful?
That's
beautiful.
That's
so
a great scene.
I think I need to program this on the submaster because I'm going to need it quite a few times. It's quite simple. If you look at the board, there's just a button that says record. Hit record button, and
Submaster 23 looks pretty good.
No, that's full blast. I don't want to lose that.
Okay, Submaster 22 looks pretty good.
Yeah, so I'm going to hit Submaster 22. There's a bump button on that. I hit that button, and now I'm going to bring down all these lights, and now they're programmed into Submaster 22. And now that scene, I can use it as often as I want, and I can set the levels on that. And it's really easy to use to where now I can add part of this into scenes. I can record this anywhere I want, and it's available anytime I need, because I'm going to need this a lot, I think.
Now, as you can see, if you look on the monitor, there are a bunch of different colors, or there are two different colors right now for different channels. There's the orange and the yellow. If the channel color is yellow, that means that the submaster is in control. If it's orange, that means that the individual channel fader is in control of the light board.
And then there are also a few other colors. We'll tell you about those later.
When we get to them.
Oh, and one more thing. You see we've only got 24 right here, but really, this board has 240 submasters. I know, but they aren't all here. That's because we've got submaster pages.
I mean, who would want to have, you know, that many of everything?
So, it's pretty simple.
If you look on the board, if you look on the screen, you're going to see the soft keys. These soft keys give you separate little things that you can do, and there are a bunch of different things. By hitting 7, the more soft keys button, you can do a bunch of different ones. For instance, you can park a channel, you can delete everything solo, or etc.
But that's all irrelevant, because the pages button is just right here. You just have to hit page, and I want to be on Submaster page 10. And I hit enter, and now I've only got one from Submaster programmed, and it's quite a lovely one. It's an effects submaster. But I can use this, but since I don't need this as often as my first 10, so I programmed it on this different page. So if you have a lot of submasters you need to work with, you can program it to a different page.
About 90% of lighting is done before the night of the show. On the night of the show, you have a very simple job. You just make corrections and you hit the cues when you're supposed to, but about 90% of the job is done before the show even starts.
Actually, it's about a week before the show starts, in most shows. You know, it's generally a good idea to start a month or two, but it sometimes other things come.
We throw some stuff together in a week, and it turns out well.
Yeah. So, the first thing we're going to talk about
is gels. Gels are the different colors that you can put over light to change the color that it's going to broadcast. Right now that fluorescent light above us is broadcasting white light. But if you covered it with seven big enough to cover it, so don't... Yeah, Greg is covering this fluorescent light with that sheet, which is not nearly big enough to cover an entire fluorescent light bulb. But it changes the color of the light. It changes it in a lot of ways. What I have right here is a gel swatch book, the Roscoe Lux gel swatch book. And our gels are all Roscoe Lux brand. And these give a sample of your color, then also the percent transmittance, which is how much actual light rays are going to get through. Because when you're just focusing lights and trying to get everyone's faces covered, you may say, okay, that's the perfect brightness. And then you put all the gels over it, and it's way too dim because now there's only 35% of the lights going through, or whatever. So that's always something to keep in mind, because before you even do the colors, usually one of the most important things about lighting is to make sure that the actor's faces are seen. And that's kind of the boring part of lighting design, is getting the whole stage over. But it's a really important part, because it looks bad if actors are walking in and out of shadows and their faces are only half covered. Because...
Take it from here, Greg. Because parents come to shows to see their kids, and if you only have lights coming down on top of their heads, you have this nice long shadow, and it just looks terrible. If you have light shining in from all the angles, then you can actually see the actor, and it looks a lot better. It may not even be something that you really think is a big deal until you see the difference, and then you're like, whoa, that's a big deal. Now, obviously, a light is not this big. The fluorescent lights are this big, but the lights we'll be using are not this size. So what we need to do is we need to cut these gels to the appropriate size. We have three different types of lights that we can gel. We have a source 4, we have a Fresnel, we have a Sight, and we have a work light. We actually have four types. So they're each different sizes. This one is a source 4. As you can see, it's already been cut and already been put in. There's a simple gel case right here. And then you take the gel and you cut it. Yes, there's a frame. What you would simply do is line it up and you would just cut along and cut the side and you'll actually have a nice square. And then you take the square and you put it in. We also have a couple other sizes, which Wesley grabbed. This is a Fresnel size. As you can see, it's slightly larger than the Source 4, so they're not interchangeable. The larger ones go on the Fresnels. The Fresnels look like this and are found on the electric bars.
Now, Fresnel is a French word, so in certain political climates, we have to call them freedom nails. Just keep that in mind.
Also, the Source 4 is this monstrosity. It's a very, very nice, I like this light. It's my favorite light. I want to buy one, but they're really expensive. So, this is Source 4. As you can see, the gel simply goes right here, you move it over, and you unclip it, and you can just put the gel frame right inside and clip it back in. Okay, moving on to the other two types of frames. This is a Sight light frame. The Sight lights, if you look, are not turning on right now. There we go. Are the ones in the top, you can see them right there, the colored ones at the top. They're designed to light up that white screen in the back. Yeah, there you go. Those lights right there. They are great mainly for setting moods and for setting time of days and settings, because they are able to light up the entire background. The final type of gel frame is the work light frame. You will really only ever put one color in here ever, and that is dark blue.
These are lights that are on stage that we would hardly ever use them in an actual productions, that we would hardly actually use them to light actors' faces, because they're frankly very ugly when they show up on stage. But when the crew is making scene changes, we have these gel blue and we turn them up probably about 15% to give them just enough light to work with.
As you can see right now, there's a very, very slight change on stage. You might not be able to see that, but there's a very slight change. Those are the work lights. It's not enough to where an audience member can really notice, but it's enough where when you're on stage, there's a huge amount of light.
So it's always important to, when your script calls for work lights,
you need to make sure that you put them in, because you probably won't want to program them into a queue for reasons we'll explain later. But you need to make sure that they're on, because that can be a safety issue for the crew on stage, because if they don't have the proper light to work with, people can get hurt.
In our last show, we had someone actually fall off the stage while they were moving a piece of set. That was not fun.
So when you come together to do your lighting design, usually the thing you'll do is you'll go through your script, go through every scene. First look at the things like, when an actor comes on from the left side of the stage, I need to have light on the left side of the stage. First look at basic things like that, like when am I going to have light on people and where and how bright. That's the basics of it. And then after you've figured that out, then you can look at each scene and say, okay, this is a nighttime romantic scene. I want to have nighttime romantic colors, which might be, you know, some special kind of blues, maybe a little bit of purple in there, maybe a bit of red. And then, of course, then you might also look through another one. This is a daytime happy, yay scene. So you'll get, you know, maybe we'll put in a little yellows, a bit of orange, you know, maybe even put in a sun gobo in the background. So then, so after you've figured out where the light's going to be, then you go through every scene and you try to figure out where my colors are going to be. What are these colors going to do? How are they going to set a mood? So the first step is to figure out where the light's going to be, and then the second step is to set a mood. Different scenes can have different moods. Even if it seems like a simple enough scene, you can set a mood to it. You need to, and that's where you consult with the director. The director's going to have a vision for how the characters are supposed to develop, how the overall plot is supposed to develop, how the different scenes are supposed to be set up. So before you as the lighting designer start making decisions, you need to look at the director and find out what his or her vision for how the lights and how the moods of the different scenes is going to be. The director is going to give you guidance, but most directors will also give you a lot of freedom to say, okay, I want this scene to have a romantic mood, and it's about 6 o'clock at night in this scene. So then from that, you can say, okay, well, I'm probably going to want it not too bright. You know, I'm going to want a bit of blues, a bit of red. I may want to focus the light in different ways on the actor's face, because usually in romantic scenes you might want to kind of close in on the actors to where you don't want to have the whole scene. You might want to focus on the actors as whatever happens that brings them into this romantic encounter. And then also you can look at, we have what's called a cyclorama or a psych, which is a white curtain on the back of the stage, which lets you set moods in the background. So when it's sunrise, you can put a little bit of pinks, a little bit of yellows, and different things on the back of that set to sort of set the mood for the scene, and then you can move on to put different colors on the actors to set mood for specific parts of that scene. Now, one thing that can be really helpful when you're trying to figure out lighting is in the light booth, we have a blue binder, which is conveniently unlabeled at all, which has your Roscoe gel catalog and Roscoe supply catalog. But then this very important, the Roscoe guide to color filters, which tells you about all the different colors they have in different applications. Let's say, for example, that I looked in my gel swatch book and I saw, you know what, I like gel number 26, light red. But I wonder what the professional lighting designers have to say about it and about what it should be doing. I'll say, huh, I bet the Roscoe gel catalog says so. And it says, gel number 26, light red, vibrant red, good alternate primary. That wasn't very helpful. Often they can be more helpful though. Like right here, this one also says, all right, if you look at number 69, Brilliant Blue, which says used for dramatic moonlight effects, which you could have been saying, I need a moon. I really do. And I need it to be dramatic. And you found it right there. So you can order that gel, and you can gel your moon, and it's you and get your dramatic place. Moonlight. And this, you shouldn't. Of course, you always have to use your own judgment when you put it up there. You might look it up and say, I don't like that as a mood. And that's your prerogative as a lighting designer to decide what you really want. So that's why it's sometimes, if the money is available, it sometimes is nice to order several alternatives so you can experiment and try to figure out with how you really want your vision to be. And as you get more experienced in lights, you'll soon sort of discover, just even by looking at these, even by looking at these small samples, which aren't big enough to even shine through to really give you an accurate
picture of just if you hold it up to a light, but you may soon be able to figure out exactly how it's going to look on stage and figure out how, in your mind, how it's going to bring the director's vision and the writer's vision to the stage.
For instance, a great reason that you want to check them before you hang them is because the day before a show, Wes and I decided that we needed to replace some lights. As you can see up there, there are two lights up there. One of them is white, one of them is blue. If you were to actually go up there, there are two dark blue gels on them. However, one of the gels, for some reason, is not very effective, so it shines out as kind of a duller blue. It's designed for a very subtle effect. However, we wanted dark nighttime, so the day of the show, we figured that out during a show that it was actually
dark. But if you look, that one is R359, has a transmittance of 9%, the dark blue one. And then the daylight blue, which is the other one, has a transmittance of 35%. So that white one is letting out almost 4 times as much light as that other one. So you can see how much difference that makes. Even though if you just looked at these samples, you would have said, oh, those are pretty close. They'll probably even swap between each other.
Cues form the basis for your show. What you do with a cue is you set your scene.
Wait, stop. We have one more. You guys should have the lead as a master.
Oh.
Back to the Now.
We'll fix it in post, right?
Yeah, we'll fix it in post.
All right.
Now, if you want to delete a submaster, it's fairly simple. If you look on the monitor, you can see a bunch of different things on the bottom here. These are all separate controls. On the board, there are a bunch of buttons labeled S1, S2, S3, S4, S5, S6, X7, and S8. Those stand for soft keys. All these are soft keys. If you look at number 7, that's the more soft key button, and I can go through and these give me a bunch of different options I can do. If you look right now, number 6 is the delete. I can actually go to S6 and delete. Now, the default is to delete a cue, because the most common thing you're going to be working with on the board is cues. So if I want to delete submaster number 22, which is the one that we just programmed, I would go to delete, which I'm in right now, and then I would hit the sub button on the board, submaster, and then I would just come over to 22 and hit 22. And then it's going to ask me if I want to delete the submaster, so I'm going to hit enter, and then because deleting is such a bad thing, if you delete something that you don't want to, it's going to ask you to confirm it, so you're going to hit enter again. And now channel 22 does absolutely nothing.
Okay, and now we're going to move on to cues.
Oh wait, there's one more thing we need to do. Sorry.
And now we're going to move on to cues. Cues form the basis for your show. You set your scenes, you program them into cues, and then you run those cues during the show. So right now, I believe these cues are still left over from State Fair. We don't have all the scenes set, but I've got Q1 programmed and I'm going to hit go. And Q1 is set to go for 5 seconds, so it's going to take 5 seconds to bring up everything that I've set for Q1.
Our State Fair is a great State Fair. That's the scene that was on for this cue.
So, but then we've got whatever comes next, which is Q2. I just hit go again, and that brings me into Q2.
Which brings down the light 75%, because this is actually a spot cue. We'll get into that later, but when you have a spotlight on, you want to bring down all of the lights so that way it accents the spot more. And then the next cue is obviously you want to bring the lights right back up. Now, as you can see, all of these take 5 seconds to do, because 5 seconds is a very nice time for the audience to not really notice that there's a light change going on, because it takes a while. But as you just saw, if you saw it, Wes, for the last cue, went like this to make it go quickly. What this does is these actually control your rate. So if you hit go, you can actually bring this all the way down, and then this controls how quickly your cue actually goes in. So if you want, you can manually do it. So if I want this to take 2 seconds, if I want this to take like half a second, I can just go and go right up and down, and if I pull it down and up, then it immediately does it. So it's a good way to cycle through cues very quickly just by doing that.
But you're probably asking, how did they program those cues? I'm gonna tell you. So, I've got my blank slate right here. If you look at the screen, everything's off. But you know what? I'm gonna guess that we need some lights on stage. So, I need to set my first scene, which is going to include channel 10, 11, 12, 85, and 17. And that's gonna be,
and 43. See, you need 43.
All right, so if you look on stage, this is what our first scene is going to be. So we need to record this to Q1. So it's simple enough. I hit Q1 on my control panel, and then I hit record, and it's gonna ask me to confirm it, and I just press enter. And now, this is Q1. So then to begin from the top, I'm gonna say Q1, I'm gonna turn down all my faders that are manual up, and then I'm gonna hit go. And now, if you look on stage, this is the cue that we've recorded.
Now, say you're going through a run-through two nights before the show, and you realize, hey, one of the characters' faces isn't lit, and you bring up a light to try to fix that. And if I can find a light that will fix that, okay, I just brought up a light to fix that. And you want to change it, all you have to do is hit record, enter. This is very easy because eventually it gets to the point where you can just make a quick change and just, you know, record, enter, and you're done. And that's the change. And then when you bring it down, that's a permanent change. So if you look on the board right now, you can see two colors. It's the purple and the green. These are cues. Green is the cue that's in effect right now, and purple is the effect that was is the cue that was just in effect. If you make a change and record over it, the green is the change that you made, and the purple is what you originally had. So if I record this, they all become purple.
Yeah, because green is the most recent lights to come on. Purple is whatever came on in the last set of actions that happened.
Now, say you want to take a channel out. Well, right now, if you look on the board, all the dimmers are down, so you can't exactly take a channel out. So that's where we're going to use these controls right here. If you wanted to, say, take out channel 14, then you would simply go channel 14 at, and then you can set the level. You can set it to at 75, or you can go at 50, or you can go to at 31 or something. Or if you want to go to zero, go at clear, and now it's turned off.
Or at full, which is the button right below at. So you can set it to any intensity that you want. So then you can set it at zero, we want it out, or at clear, and then you can hit enter. And now it's recorded as zero. And or you could also select it, and we have what's called our trackpad here. And that lets you do several things, but it also lets you ride that level. And there are two different settings for that. There's coarse, which means it's gonna respond really quickly, or fine, where it's gonna go kind of slowly.
Now, say you wanna shake out two or three channels, like 9, 14, and 43. You would simply go channel 9, and 14, and 43, at clear, and then hit record, enter. Now, since these channels are in red, that means that they're under control of this pad. So if you wanna get them no longer under control, you can hit the release button, and they're no longer in control. However, they're still turned off because you recorded that cue.
So now that we're done with Q1, we need to go ahead and record Q2. So now I'm gonna set my scene for Q2, and I've still got Q1 up on my screen right now, so it's gonna record what's left over from Q1 in here, and that's what I want, because I'm just adding lights to Q1. So now that's my Q2, so I'm gonna hit record, Q2, enter.
And there's your Q2, you can bring everything down.
Wait, Greg, I need to have a cue between those, I just forgot. What am I gonna do?
You're gonna have to restart from the beginning.
Wait a second, I've got an idea. We can do a Q 1.5, which is between 1 and 2.
Wait, one second.
So I need to add in. So I just need to have a quick transition between, something needs to happen between Q1 and 2 that I just found out about. So I'm gonna add in, this is now my Q 1.5. So Q 1.5, record, enter. And you can use that anytime you need to put cues between other cues. And so it's helpful if you do 1.5. That way, if later you find out I need a cue between 1 and 1.5, you've still got a few numbers to work with. Because you can't go 1.05 or 1.25. Yeah. You can only do it to the tenths place.
You can do 1.1, 1.2. So it gives you 10 cues between each individual number. So if you recorded each scene 1, 2, 3, 4, then it gives you lots of room to edit with, and it's great. So now, the way to go through these cues is you can either hit back or go. Go makes you go forward, back makes you go backwards. As you can see, on our board, it tells you what cue you're on, and it programs them automatically chronologically. So that way, it goes Q1, Q1, 1.5, Q2, Q3, Q4. And if you go down here, you can see all of our cues from the last show. And apparently, we were very lucky because I don't see any 0.5s in there.
Yeah.
So now we're going to show you how to use cues in a show. This is the binder that we showed you before with all of the things in them, with all of the great Roscoe catalogs. However, we added something to it, which was the script to State Fair, which was the last show we did. Now, if you zoom in here, you can actually see, if you look in here, you can see that our script starts here. And in the top corner, we have rule number one. That's Q1. So we would hit
and
Q.
No, Greg, remind me again who started that?
Hmm?
Who started that show again? I
believe it was Mackenzie Adrians and Tim Fuchs. I believe they were the two main stars. That's okay, moving on. As you can see, as we go across here, it starts out very nice because we don't have a lot of cues. And then down here, we have cue number two, Spot Margie. So I would bring cue number two in, and it would simply bring down the lights and be my next cue. And I have cue three. And it's a very efficient system because as you go through here, you can see all of the cues that you need. And it's great. Now, here you can see that I had a 10.4 and 10.6. And when you get to the line, for instance, when it's a great State Fair, hey, I would bring up this next cue. As you can see right here, I have a blackout written. I have Q4 going, was the cue I had, and then I had a blackout that I needed. Now, the best way to do a blackout with a cue is actually with the clear button. What this will do is it'll black out the lights immediately and bring them all straight down, and it'll be very quick. So if you look at the stage right now, you can actually see I'm gonna hit the clear button and the lights go immediately out. And now I'm gonna bring up my work lights so that way people can actually do a scene change. Oh, what is that?
You're right.
So now I'm going to bring up my work lights. And yeah, that works pretty well. So, now for the next scene, we're already programmed to go right into Q5. So I'm going to hit go, and it's going to bring up Q5, and we're already ready.
So,
already ready. You can just go straight through here and look through them, and it works very well.
Okay, so,
now, as you can see here, we have two separate sets of faders. You have your AB fader, and you have your CD fader. These are two separate cues, so if I run a cue here, and then I run a separate cue here, we have both Q6 and Q7 running at the same time. So if I want to cancel Q7, and I hit go to go to Q8, Q7 is still in effect. So this can really mess up your show. So make sure that when you're doing a show, you only use one of these. The only time you'll use two is if you want two cues going at the same time. We've only ever actually done that one time, which was during the Jungle Book, where we had a very, very long scene change, and we wanted to gradually go from night into morning. So we had a blue fade in, we had a night scene fade into a morning scene over the course of 3 minutes, which you can actually do by going in here, and when you go hit your cue, you can change the time on by hitting time, and then you can punch in your time, and you hit, there are two separate things. You have an up fade time and you have a down fade time. The up fade time is how quickly the lights go up, because for every cue, some lights are going to go up and some lights are going to go down. And for some scenes, you'll want the lights to go up quickly and then the ones to go down slowly so the audience doesn't notice as much. But for most cues, you're going to want them to be exactly the same. So say we want this cue to take 2 seconds, I'm going to hit 2, enter, and then down fade time, 2, enter. And now the cue, instead of taking 5 seconds, will only take 2 seconds. However, if say we wanted to take 3 minutes, then we would simply take 3 and multiply it by 60, and doing some quick math, we'll get 180 seconds. So we'll do time, 180, enter, 180, enter. And now this will take a very long time to do.
All right, I've got better things to do than sit through a 2-minute and 20-second cue.
So we're not going to run it, but that's what you would do if you did run it. And then what you would do is simply, when you get to the next cue, you would clear the other cue that was in effect, and now this is no longer in effect, and you will have your A and B.
So that's cues, but let's also talk about effects cues. If we go back to that submaster we saw, Submaster 24, or actually Submaster 240, because it's on page 24, you know, at the stage, all the lights were flashing, which can be pretty freaking cool. So, we may come into times where, for some reason or another, we need to have flashing lights on stage. That's easy enough to record. So I'm gonna go, and you can either record that as a cue or as a submaster. We're gonna record it as a cue.
So what I have to do is, first I need to set my scene for the first frame. Flashing lights are set up, or when you have it's called an effects cue, and those are set up in different frames, which is each different scene that you have running. So this is gonna be,
say for instance, you have your Q1, and you wanted to have the lights flashing in the background, the different colored lights, and you wanted to go from all of the green to all of the blue, and then back and forth. Then the way to do this would be an effects cue.
So first I'm gonna, my first frame, I want all my greens. So there's, I've turned up my three channels with green. So I'm gonna, now I'm gonna hit Q600, type, and then number three is effect. So number three, it's now an effect, and now I hit record, enter. And now it's easy enough. And now it's easy enough to just add in my next channel. So now I'm gonna have, now I have all my blues. And now I can record that. Record, enter. And that's my next frame. So now I can do Q600, go, and I accidentally recorded Q1 into there, but you'll notice that it's now flashing. But then the nice thing is I can also set, that's going way too fast for me. I need to be in beat with the music or whatever. So on the
So what you would do is you would hit the rate button,
and which is next to your cue faders,
and you can actually use this pad here to control how fast it's going. Like right there, you can barely see it, and these lights are gonna explode soon. So I've got to bring that down, or you can go.
And now we have what I have in my hands, one of the most important tools of lighting design.
Moment of silence for the greatness of the gaff tape.
This is gaffer's tape.
That is not silence, okay?
This tape, it's like if you took duct tape and made it infinitely more awesome
and painted it black,
you would have gaffer's tape. Now the beauty of gaffer's tape is a few things. One, duct tape is gonna melt really quick if you have it on a light. Gaffer's tape takes a little longer. Gaffer's tape also doesn't stick to itself the way duct tape does.
So if you're trying to tape something and you accidentally put the tape on like that.
Yeah, if it were duct tape, you'd never have stickiness out of this again. With gaff tape,
you can just pull it right apart and it works just fine.
Yeah. So.
So what you would do is, I mean, you can just take it right off and it works right away. Now, Wes is actually joking there because luckily, because the stuff is so stick, okay, he wasn't joking, but normally it wouldn't hurt.
Yeah, gaffer tape is very sticky, but it's also, and it's also waterproof, and it also,
it's not messy, so it doesn't, duct tape, when it's on something for a very long time, gets that really nasty residue. Gaffer tape normally does not.
It leaves an essence of awesomeness, though.
It does.
That is,
you touch it, and you just become more awesome just by touching it. It's great.
Now, this is 2-inch rolls of gaff. They're also available 4-inch rolls, which, yeah, and
they're pretty awesome.
Yeah, so gaffer's tape, use them when you're taping down cables. You use them
when you're taping gels. If the gel doesn't fit right, you need to tape it in place. As you can see, we have lots of gaffer's tape all around the wall. We have a cable right over here, as you can see. I mean, we have posters up here taped up with gaff tape. I wouldn't recommend doing that though, because it's fairly expensive. But we have nice cables all along this wall that are taped up directly with gaffer's tape. And it's very, very nice, because it's great for that.
Yeah. So remember, in the theater, gaff tape is pro. So, but it's expensive. This roll, when it was full, cost us $20. A 4-inch roll cost almost $50. So
yeah, that will go into your lighting budget that hopefully you'll get from your director.
Safety is something very important with lights. That's a 750-watt light bulb. Probably the hottest one you have in your house is 100 watts. That thing gets hot. That's why we have gloves when we're handling lights. When you're handling the lights that have been on, you wear gloves, otherwise you'll get burned. And then also another important thing is be careful about electrical safety. Our lighting system has a 300-amp, 3-phase circuit delivering power to it. Your house probably has about 100 amps. Through our lighting system, there's more electricity than, it's about 3 times the average electricity that could go through a house. It's a lot of electricity and it could kill you if you're not careful. So you always need to follow the guidelines and the safety procedures that we're gonna show you when you're hanging lights. Because this is a system that's set up to be very safe, and it's hard. It can be hard to electrocute yourself. using this system, but it's still a possibility, and with electricity this high, you have to be careful. You never want to be screwing around too much. When you're dealing with that much electricity and that much heat.
All right, we better get going. I'm just gonna leave and we'll leave this up there.
Yeah, fire code hazard.
Oh.
Never leave this up. Cause, yeah. Well, honestly, you should never even put it up here, but we just had it up here because it's easier to show. So now we're gonna show you how to take down a source four efficiently.
So, first thing, we should probably unplug this.
Probably.
So, now usually you would have the circuit turned off first before you unplugged it, but we are plugged into a wall here. Yes. So
now, the next thing you would do is probably, since we're putting this light away and we're done with it, we're going to degel it. So always have gloves on because this hot, this thing is about 300 degrees. So Wes, I'll give you $300 to lick this.
300?
Yeah.
That's 100 for each degree.
I know.
Or no, it's $1 for each degree. Well, that was very poor math. Well, I guess for the 10 degree burn I would get.
True. So what we're going to do now is take out the gel. When you take this out, you're going to take it out very, very slowly because otherwise it gets caught. And gels can die. Well, we'll show you. Sorry. One of our gels recently perished, and it was a close friend of ours.
He was the best gel. He was our first gel.
He was our first gel that we ever owned.
Gobo!
He was the first Gobo that we ever owned. Sorry, these are not gels, these are Gobos. And his name was Satan. He was a little Gobo Satan, and we have him projected on the ceiling all the time. Wes, if you would. He was a dear friend of ours, so. But this is what happens when you pull him out too quickly. He gets caught, and it's.
He'll never shine light again. He's always brought light into our lives.
He'll never block light from coming through, rather.
Alright, so let's take this light down. We've got a funeral to go to.
The funeral.
Yes, we have a funeral. We have a funeral we have to get to for Satan, so.
So, it's pretty much the reverse of what you did to put it on. You just start loosening this with your handy wrench.
And the person doing the wrenching is not going to have gloves on because the person holding the light will have gloves on because this thing is very hot.
So, and if you can hold it up a little bit, because I think I'm ready to loosen it up. And now, it's free. And then the next thing, we just unclamp the safety cable because it's not going to go very far with that on.
And we just take this, and we store it away. Since these have great stands right on the front, you can actually just take them and lay them right down face up. And it works out very well.
Okay, yeah, well,
since we're going to our funeral, we should probably kill everything. So we're going to turn the lights off. However, we need to get out of here. So we will turn this channel back on by lowering the master and bringing it back up. And then all the channels that are on are back on. So we can now get out.
All right, we'll finish up this show tomorrow, Greg. So yep. I need to make sure I turn off the lights before I go to save energy.
Yep.
Always keep the lights on until everyone is clear for the room.
Oh, I think I broke my leg.
We're here for day two of Lighting Design Palooza 07.
We're going to start showing you how to run the fly system.
All right, now the fly system, well, this is something that safety is another critical factor in. The fly system, it has to be carefully weighed so these bars, so when we release it, it should mostly stay stable, but then when I pull it, it shouldn't give me too much resistance either way. And so we have our three electric bars, which are properly weighted, usually, on connected to our fly system. So, we'll take a look at third electric over here. I need to change some lights, so I'm at the wrong bar. So I can trace it. Here is third electric. So, first there's a clip here that I can have to pull forward. And it feels like this bar is poorly weighted. So, and now I can hold on tight. Actually, it isn't too bad. It's a little heavy. But, so now, in order to pull down, in order to make the bar go down, I pull the rope down. And conversely, in order to make it go up, I pull the rope up. And if you're experiencing a lot of resistance, it can be helpful to pull this second rope to help you get it up. Now, but if you do have a waiting problem, this can be solved. You have to pull your fly up to its extremity, and always have another person here to help you in case you lose your balance, because these stage weights, which are conveniently stored right over here, can be heavy, but they can then be by standing on top of this. You can then lift this implement up, and then, very carefully, place this on top of here, insert one notch into the side, lift it up, then lower it into position. And now you have a carefully weighted lighting bar. Now, this can make an incredible difference. So usually one weight can often be enough to correct an improperly balanced bar. Now this bar is probably not well balanced now. You'll notice that it requires much more effort to pull it up, and that it also rises back up on its own, which is a sign that it is not properly weighted. So, and then you can do the same thing when it's improperly weighted and release it, always keeping in mind that you should have someone else there to help you because it can be quite dangerous. But so, now we're going to look at what's called the Socapex cable. This is a cable that allows you to put six lighting signals through one conduit, saving you a lot of cable space. Now, after you've plugged it in, you need to get a way to get it broken out. So, we have what's called the Socapex breakout cable, which would be connected to a Socapex standard cable. So, in order to connect that, this can be one of the most maddening, annoying jobs to do. So, first we have, there's this panel, the one on stage left, and there's also a panel on the left and right lofts that have Socapex outlets, which look like these. First step is to unscrew the cap. The cap is unscrewed. And now, the next thing to do is, on your cable, you can find a small notch, and you will find an identical, but not identical because it's opposite, notch on the cable connector. You need to get these two notches matched up. So, all you do, get the notches matched up, and then start screwing. You
son of a... Also, if you would like to do this manually, you could actually run cords directly from these ports right here, and you wouldn't have to. This just works well as a extension cord, so you can save cables.
Yes, in just a bit we'll show you a setup that has worked excellent for using these Socapex cables. You'll notice that this is channel 68 to 73, and this is also 68 to 73. These are running from the same circuits, but they're just different ways to route it.
So, one of the most basic things you'll have to do as lighting techie is turn on the lights. As simple as it sounds, it can actually be a big pain. However, we have our house lights out here. As you can see, we have two types of house lights. We have these ones here, and then we have some much bigger ones. Those are called the halogen lights. We're going to show you how to turn those on, because they're not turned on normal. Well, it's simple. It's important to actually do. Don't take a picture.
I was trying to focus. It's halfway.
Come back on me. So, the way to do this is by this panel right here. What you're going to do are, there are five light switches. The top ones are to turn them on, the bottom ones are to turn them off. Since they suck, you generally need to hit them about five times. So we're going to go on. Because these lights are so big, they generally take a little while to warm up. So what you're going to do is you're going to wait a couple minutes until you actually see a difference in the lighting. If you want to turn up the actual house lights, you'll go to this panel right here and bring up the house button. We'll actually show you how to use this panel more efficiently next.
This is a halogen.
Dun dun!
So we're now ready to begin. We've finished our lighting design, we've got our plan in mind, so let's get to the hanging and focus session. First, I've got my Altman Fresnel right here. First thing to do to hang it is just toss the clamp right up there, and then, of course, the safety cable. So, and now it is safely there, and now I pull out my handy wrench. And first you just pull it finger tight. It's much like the Source 4. And then you just tighten it down. And then you've got your hanging stage pin connector. But luckily, you've got an empty outlet. You'll notice how they conveniently plug right together. And now our light is plugged in and ready to be focused.
If you notice, above all of the light outlets, there is a number. This is the corresponding channel number, so you know actually how to program them into the board. So if you have a specific color that you want to gel these, which by the way you would simply be doing by inserting a gel in this slot right here, that'd be very easy to do.
And then
oftentimes, as you can see, most of the time you're only going to have Fresnels and the halogen work lights at the same time on here. However, in one case, for one show, we actually had a Source 4. A lot of times, you're going to want to have some special effects, and a Source 4 is one of these. For instance, during the last show, we actually had a moon projected right about there.
So we turned flying pretty high.
Yes, it was. For those of you who don't get that, that was a pun from State Fair. That was the line.
The Earth is a glow.
You can stop now. So, what happened was we would actually fix the light and fix where the moon was going to be, and we would focus them to where we could light up the moon whenever we wanted using the Source 4. Oftentimes you can put gobos in here too if you want to put a shape on the back of the curtain. We did that a lot for Jungle Book. We also hung them up in the loft. Hanging them up in the loft is actually very, very simple. You would simply hang them on the bars right there if you can see them, and then you just connect them to the channels that we showed you earlier right over there.
And now let's take a look at some of our current active setups that we have. Let's take a look at our overhanging sights. So now we're gonna take, so I showed you the Socapex connector earlier, and this is our current active setup that uses Socapex. You can see this thick cable in the back comes in and it attaches to a Socapex end, which then breaks out into six different channels, which these sights are configured in. And I have one of these channels on to show you how lovely the sight looks. So, but you know what? You notice how those are pretty colors? That's a huge pain. Greg, would you mind showing them how you could possibly get one of these gels onto one of those lights?
I would not mind.
Now, you see,
up until last year, we actually had a problem of taking these frames completely out, putting the gel in, and then trying to fix them back in. These are a pain to put in these things. So now we actually discovered, through the help of our math teacher, Mrs. Crosley, who is stage director right now for the shows, she actually discovered this trick. If you keep it in, if you look very closely at how these fit together, there's a little switch right here. And this switch connects these two metal pieces together. If you unhook it, you can actually separate this. Then what you simply do is you just slide the gel in where you can see it, and then raise it up, put it, and make sure that these two corners are underneath this little latch here, and then just hook it in, and then you have your gel. It's a lot easier than doing it the old way. So, like we said earlier today, kids are so lucky.
So right behind here is the demo rack. And luckily, it's protected by this impenetrable piece of metal. It was originally going to be a wall with a door. They started it about 3 years ago. I haven't gotten around to finishing it. So be very careful, because this can really hurt if you cut yourself on it. So we're going to come on in, and we'll show you the dimmers. This is on the stage left loft. Stage left loft, yes. We're now here in the dimmer room protected by our impenetrable fort. So. But I need to get into this dimmer rack. Oh no, it's locked. So, but luckily on top of this thingy over here are the keys. I insert the key, much like you would in your lock at home, turn the key, and then it is open. And this is our dimmer rack. This contains 48 breakers, which each contain two dimmers. And this is what your lighting board sends a signal from itself to here. And then this thing is what actually controls what the amount of electricity that goes to those lights. Let's take a look at one of these guys. They pull out quite nicely, and there really is no electrical danger of doing this. Even if the signal is hot, you can pull it out and it disconnects and it's fine. But one of the problems that happens is dust collects in here. This is a very dusty environment. So every now and then, we recommend at least once a year cleaning these out.
Wes, are you telling me that dust can get through our impenetrable wall?
You know, I had a tough time believing it myself, but there's dust in here. And basically, the way you clean it out, you just blow it. I wouldn't recommend doing this if you have a lot of dust allergies. And then you can just slides right back in, same way you put it out.
Also, it doesn't matter which dimmer goes into which spot, so if you pull out 10 of them to clean them at one time and forget which one goes where, it doesn't really matter because they're all exactly the same.
And then another thing is these, which also help to protect the dimmer from collecting too much dust, these collect a lot of it. And these also need to be cleaned out at least once every 6 months, according to Electronic Theater Control's Sensor Dimmer Manuals. So now we're going to look at this lighting control panel, which is fairly simple to run. It's meant to be used by people who don't know anything about lights. So we'll show you how to use it. So there are...
Ouch. Go.
So there are a couple buttons on here. There's the manual button, the record button, presets 1 through 4, and the off button. Presets 1 through 4 are not used. They have been recently deactivated. And there's also the manual button is the main controls button that you'll be using. Usually it'll be in manual mode. So we have 6 different zones on here. Zone 1 is the stage work lights. Brings up the stage work lights. Zone 2 is the pit. Brings up the pit. Zone 3 is the house. Brings up the house. And so on. They are labeled on the board and also labeled on the corresponding control panel backstage. But what if, for some reason, someone accidentally records the wrong thing on this panel? Shocking, I know, that someone who doesn't know about lights would be messing with this panel. But it happens, amazingly. So, let's just say that Zone 1 got screwed up. Like, let's just say that someone had programmed all the Fresnels onto it, when it's just supposed to have the work lights, because Fresnels are $100 bulbs. So, we'll say, well, that's a problem. I better fix it. So, what you do here is, I'm going to turn on the stage work lights. Well, these aren't very many. That's probably why they programmed the Fresnels in there. But, so this is, I've just turned on the stage work lights on the board. To record it, it's simple. All you do is there's a record button, you press it, and you bring the fader up. And now, if you take a look on our beautiful stage, you probably can't tell, but the work lights are now recorded.
So, now we're going to show you how to operate the Spotlight of Doom, because that's what we named it. This is an old spotlight. Hopefully by the time you're watching this, we'll have a new spotlight in this part section. I'm sorry, yeah, that's a joke of mine. But hopefully this section will be irrelevant, although that never happened. Now, it's very simple to show how to use this, if you know how to use it, so I'll show you. On the back here, you can see there's a switch. It's marked with a piece of glow tape, so if the lights are off, it'll still go in there and you can see it. It's on, off. It's very simple. You see it? See? Now it's on. Now it's off. Now it's on. Now it's off. So, the next part is to show you the gels. A lot of times in shows, you'll want to have a much duller light or a specific light, so you can change the color of the gel. You do this by simply lowering these. If you look on the inside, as I pull this down, it pushes a lever up, pushing a red gel into it. So now when I turn it on, it's actually red. Now it's white, now it's purple, now it's white, blue,
whoa,
greenish, whoa, kind of, yellow,
whoa,
green,
whoa.
We don't really know what this one is. It's supposed to be pink, but it's kind of just an empty.
And now the douser.
That douses it to where there's absolutely no light going through. This will come in handy if you want to do a quick on instead of actually hitting the on switch because it's a lot slower. The next part of running the spotlight is the size. If you look on stage, I can actually change the size of the spotlight. This comes in handy if you want to spot one person or if you want to spot an entire group. You do this simply by
turning this red handle right here. If you take it, you can turn it. This is small, big, etc. And that's pretty much the spotlight of Doom. If you actually want to come in here and take a very close look, you can actually see how the spotlight works.
One recommendation. On opening night, don't touch this bulb with your bare hand.
It's very hot. Also, generally, you don't want to look directly at it, because it tends to be fairly bright. So you don't actually want to look at it with your bare hand, with your bare eyes.
This has been Dryden High School's production of the lighting instructional video. For more information on lighting, visit Electronic Theater Controls at etcconnect.com or the International Alliance of Theatrical Stage Employees at iatse-intl.org. For more information on how you can get involved in lighting at Dryden High School, contact a member of the music or drama team.